Hi, and welcome to today's video on cyber law in a Singapore context. My name is Ian Low, and I'm the SVP for cybersecurity for the group. This presentation was also put together with the help of Alexandra Yap, who is a partner with Ellen and Gladhill, heading their fintech practice. The objective of this presentation is to raise your awareness of the laws in Singapore relating to cybersecurity, to allow you to understand basic legal clauses and how they apply in Singapore, and to enable you to identify certain security breaches and to report them to cybersecurity team and to legal. So to recap, let me redefine what is cybersecurity. Well, in Singapore context, under Section 2 of the Singapore Cybersecurity Act 2018, cybersecurity is defined as the state in which a computer or computer system is protected from unauthorized access or attack, and because of that state, the computer is available, the integrity is there, and the confidentiality of the information is maintained. With that in mind, you might ask, how does legislation control cybersecurity and cybercrime? Well, the law defines what is a cybersecurity-related offence and how are the offence committed. To understand more about the relevant legislation in Singapore, I have listed out the links to some of the more common ones: the Computer Misuse Act, Cybersecurity Act, Personal Data Protection Act, and the Penal Code. There might be others that you might be interested in, like the MAS regulation for banks and IMDA regulations for Infocom. And if you're dealing with Europe, there is also a link to the GDPR from the European Union. Let me begin with the Computer Misuse Act. Well, the Computer Misuse Act was enacted in 1993 to regulate the unauthorized use of computers to access or modify data. So this is the basic law that we would use for most computer crimes. Well, over time, there has been some changes. And in 2017, there were four amendments made. And these are pretty important. One is it made it an offense to obtain, retain, or supply personal information obtained through cybercrime. It made it an offense to obtain items which can be used to commit crime. And it now lets us go after criminals who are not in Singapore. The location has been expanded and also allow the amalgamation of cybercrime charges. Let me now go through a few examples of what these crimes are. Well, the most well-known of these, obviously, is hacking. So what is hacking? Hacking is also known as unauthorized access. According to the law, what defines hacking is knowingly cause a computer to perform any function for the purpose of securing access without authority to any programs or data held in the computer. On the left, you can see some of the cases that have been prosecuted by the court. Another common crime is website defacement. This would be covered under Section 5 of the CMA, which covers an unauthorized modification of the content of any computers, which in this case cover websites. And again, on the left, some of the cases we have seen. Now, this is an interesting one. Section 6 of the CMA states that any person who knowingly secure access without authority to any computer for the purpose of obtaining direct or indirect any computer services. What this means is that if you use your neighbor's Wi-Fi without permission, it is a crime under CMA. As you can see from the left, although this is a little known law, there have been prosecution on this way back in 2006. The next one is pretty straightforward. Using ransomware or launching a denial of service attack is an offense. I guess this one is pretty clear. Well, the next one is not so clear. Under the law, under Section 8 of the CMA, if you disclose your username and password to someone else, knowing that they might be using it for committing a crime, then you have committed an offense under CMA. So be very careful when people ask you for your username and password. Section 8B is an interesting one. This is an offense for a person to obtain or retain any item including hacking tools with the intent to use it to commit or facilitate commission of an offense. That means the possession of hardware, software used to crack passwords or steal information is by itself a crime. And I just want to share a little thought here that if you are a victim of ransomware, paying the ransom may be a crime under Section 44, Subsection 1 of the Corruption, Drug Trafficking and Other Serious Crimes Act. In this case, be very careful, consult with legal, and as a note, Cybersecurity Agency of Singapore recommends not paying up, as there's no guarantee that the hacker will decrypt the files as promised after they receive the payment. It's much better to have a backup and restore from your backup. So remember I mentioned there were some amendments to the CMA? Well, this is one of them. People ask about the territorial scope of the Computer Misuse Act. In Section 11 of the CMA, it states that the Act have effect in relation to any person, whatever his nationality or citizenship, outside as well as within Singapore, if they, one, committed the crime while they were in Singapore, two, the target system was in Singapore, three, it caused significant risk of serious harm to entities in Singapore. Well, you might ask, what does it mean by serious harm in Singapore? It's covered under subsection 4, which are the following. That being said, it's often very difficult to prosecute someone who is not in the country. So please do take care of your systems. Next, we'll touch a little bit about the Cybersecurity Act. The Cybersecurity Act establishes a legal framework for the oversight and maintenance of national cybersecurity in Singapore. Its four key objectives are to strengthen the protection of critical information infrastructure, also known as CII, against cyber attack, to authorize CSA to prevent and respond to cybersecurity threats and incidents, establish a framework for sharing cybersecurity information, and establish a light touch licensing framework for cybersecurity service providers. The key features of the Act is the appointment of a commissioner, who at this point is the chief executive of the cybersecurity agency, and the identification of critical information infrastructure. While NTUC does not have any CIIs, this might change in the future. The Act also empowers the commissioner to respond to cybersecurity threats or incidents in Singapore. And lastly, it has a light framework for licensing of two major services which might impact us. One is the Managed Security Operations Center, which has not been in effect yet, and the second one for pen testing services, which is already in effect. The next topic would be around the Personal Data Protection Act, or PDPA. The PDPA establishes a data protection law that comprises various rules governing the collection, use, disclosure, and care of personal data. There are mainly two parts to this. One is the data protection provisions, and the second is a do not call registry. The purpose of this is that by regulating the flow of personal data among organizations, it hopes to strengthen and entrench Singapore's competitiveness and position us as a trusted world hub for businesses. So this Act is treated very seriously by the authorities. The Act defines personal data as data, whether true or not, about an individual. It could be living or deceased, and can be identified from that data or from that data and other information to which the organization is likely to have access to. Now, a way to get around this is to anonymize data, because anonymized information is not personal data. And all organizations in the private sector must comply to this Act. At this point, the public sector is not covered under PDPA, but that might be changing soon in a new revision. And of course, there are exceptions to this, right? If you're acting on your personal basis, or you're working in the course of your employment for an organization, public sector organization, and business contact information, sharing your business contacts, like in your business cards, is not against the PDPA. Now, what is important for us working in an organization, we have to observe the key obligations under the PDPA. I will list them up now. Firstly, there must be consent that must be obtained for any collection, use, or disclosure from our customers. Next, we must limit the purpose and only use them for the purpose which we've disclosed. We must also notify relevant individuals when we do so in terms of the collection, use, or disclosure of their information. And we also must be accountable for the use of the data and the storage of the data. We must also ensure with reasonable effort that the data we collect is accurate. We must have reasonable protection, and we should not keep data longer than we need them. And if we transfer any data outside of Singapore, we must be transferring to a country with comparable protection as the PDPA. As of this current moment, the penalties is up to 1 million, but there are talks of increasing this to be based on the percentage of the revenue of a company. So be very careful of how we deal with personal data. I will now go over briefly regarding the EU's GDPR. I'm sure you have heard of the GDPR, as it's quite widely publicized. Well, it came into force on 25th May 2018, and the Act is essentially trying to preserve data about European Union citizens. It covers personal data, and it also determines some definitions like who are data controllers and who are data processors. So to be clear, the GDPR will not apply based on the nationality of the relevant individuals. It's mainly to focus on organizations that are established within the EU, to organizations that offer goods and services to individuals within the EU, and to organizations that monitor the behavior of individuals within the EU. What this means is that it increases accountability for organizations and increases the individual rights, and mandatory data breach provision, that means to regulate what must be reported. So if we ever go global and there are customers shopping online and we are monitoring their shopping behavior, we will be subjected to GDPR. To end, I'll quickly touch on some of the things in the penal code. So some of the crimes are covered under penal code. So example, online cheating. Online cheating is covered under section 415 of the penal code. And although it uses a computer to commit the crime, it is still covered under penal code and not necessarily need something like CMA. Online scams, like online love scam that extorts money from the victims, it's also covered under section 385 of the penal code and not the CMA. And I'm sure you heard of doxing. In May 2019, the Protection from Harassment Act 2014 was amended to include doxing. So doxing somebody online, again, it's not under CMA, but it's under the Protection from Harassment Act. Well, that's it for this session, and I hope you find this information useful in your work. If you have any questions, please drop me a line in email, and I'll try to answer your questions. Thank you.